time to start church. Good morning. How's everybody this morning? Good morning. Morning. Where was that little voice? Has everybody had a good week? I hope so. Well, for the announcements today, I've been asked to do the announcements, and this is something new to me, so I'm just going to read, okay? Super Bowl Sunday is February the 12th at 6 p.m., and it's going to be hosted by Brianne and John at their house. I think somebody asked whether or not you all want people to bring food or... Yes, okay. Bring a dish, something, finger foods or whatever you'd like to have, whatever you bring for a Super Bowl party. Our yearly church fast ends when? When does it end? Anybody know? Next Sunday, the 29th. We will conclude this fast by having a breakfast at 8:30 here at the church. Eggs, sausage, and bacon will be prepared by Terry, and it is being supplied. That is what the church is supplying.
He said he's doing, he told me this morning, he's doing the meats,
but he's, yes, he told me
the bacon,
the ham, and then he's also going to do an egg and ham and cheese omelet type meal on the side. So, but the meats are being supplied by the church. So we've asked that everybody would go on the website and try to put down what you would like to bring so we don't have an overabundance of one thing. And if you could, if you'd like to bring something, please bring the side that goes with ham and bacon and eggs and cheese. We are reaching the end of our Calvary talent rotation, so we have really enjoyed hearing and watching everybody participate. Please let Pam know if you'd like to do a special and be on our talent rotation. We got to hear Haley and Riel last week, and it was wonderful. They did such a good job. The church Valentine dinner is scheduled for February the 18th. Parents start lining up for your babysitter. So if you've got children and you plan to attend, line up your babysitter. Also, we will be meeting at the Chilhowee Baptist Center across from the high school at 5 p.m. That's where the dinner is going to be. The choice of food or spaghetti with meat sauce or chicken fettuccine Alfredo. So when you register, you'll have to let them know which meal that you would like to have. It's going to be baked potatoes, salad, bread, dessert, and drinks. And the cost for the dinner is $16 per person. We also have to have 20 people lined up for the caterer before we can get it scheduled. Please sign up no later than the 25th of January if you plan to come to the Valentine's couples banquet. There will be games, live bluegrass gospel music, and fellowship. The work day that was going to be scheduled for next Saturday, we've decided to postpone until the spring when it's a little bit warmer. So praise team, if you all want to come on up, we'll open in prayer. Did I get it all, Pam? Yay! All right. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for everyone that has come out, dear Lord, to worship and praise you. And dear Lord, we just ask that you come into our presence, dear Lord, and just let us feel your presence in this place. Dear Lord, bless our worship, bless the sermon, and dear Lord, bless Pastor John as he brings the message today. Dear Lord, continue to be with our pastors and his family. Dear Lord, help him and help them to feel refreshed and renewed every day and every aspect, dear Lord. Thank you, Lord. We ask that you bless this service. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Everybody ready to praise the Lord?
Yeah.
All right.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
Okay. How about everybody saying hallelujah? Praise you, Lord. Welcome to this place. Hallelujah. All right. Ready?
Yes.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is many of you know that our God is a firm foundation. As long as we keep our promise to Him to stand on His foundation, He stands on His foundation with us forever. Our God is a firm foundation, and we can always count on Him. We might be having technical difficulty. All right.
Is yours working now?
Mine.
Turn it off and then back on.
We're having technical difficulties.
Mine too.
It's working now.
Okay. Sorry, guys.
We're singing, but we can't hear anything up here, believe it or not. So it's just kind of an interesting morning.
And when you can't hear, you're not sure where you are.
Thank you for being the worshipers.
Y'all ready?
You are victorious.
Yes, Lord.
You are victorious.
Satan thinks he's got a little nudge. Did you feel when the guitar didn't want to work? We had a wonderful practice.
It still doesn't want to work.
We had a wonderful practice. We were done within, 45 minutes? And God is good. And we're not ever, ever, ever going to let Satan have an inch.
Amen.
Because our praise and worship, we don't have to have instruments. The only thing, and we're not here to perform. I just have to say this. We're not here to perform. We are here to worship and lift up Jesus Christ. So just sing with us. Praise Him. No matter what happens, we're just going to move on because He is worthy of our praise. Amen. Amen. Amen.
The sound that saves.
Life, Lord, you're right there. You're so good. You're so good to us. I just feel this morning that God wants to, He wants to meet you where you're at this morning. Whatever the situation is and the things that you've been dealing with life, He wants to meet you here this morning. A God-ordained moment in time for you. So as we worship, as we do the offering and listen to the Word, I want y'all to tune in to what God's saying to you this morning. I want you to hear what God is saying today. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Yeah. Worship team, great job, even though the difficulty hit. Way to push through. And y'all are the worship team out there. It's not us. He's the audience of one. Just continuing on with service this morning. Have y'all had a, how's y'all's week been? Good, bad, indifferent? Bad, good, amen. God is, I think that's been our theme here in this church for the last several years. God's good, no matter what, and I can't get that out of my spirit. So as we give today, you know, there's two ways we give. We give in our basket that Gary's going to pass around, and we give online. I want to encourage you to, if you're not giving, start giving. Push into what God has for you this year. Even if it's a dollar, even if it's a penny, everybody can give something. Kids, I'm going to go ahead and pray for the prayer request this morning as they're passing around the offering basket. How many of y'all have needs? How many of y'all have family members that need Jesus? I know I do. How many of you need a healing in your body? I want y'all to, as the year goes on, and we do it every year, write your prayer request out. Drop them in the offering basket, and we'll put them in our little box over here, and we'll pray for them all week long, all month, all year. And I want to hear reports. When y'all get an answered prayer, please share it. It brings encouragement to the church. Lord, I just thank you, Lord, for touching people's lives. Lord, you know their request. You know their hurts. You know their joys. Lord, you know exactly right where they're at and what they need. And Lord, we ask you this morning, Lord, to meet those needs. We ask you to meet those needs, Jesus. Amen. Children, are y'all ready for class? Are you ready? Are you sure? Are the teachers ready? Way to go, Joy. No, I didn't say go yet, LJ. Joy, you want to get a head start? Okay. All right, kids, you're dismissed to your class. Why don't you look at that crew of children rolling out? There went half our church again. Sarah, I think we had a special this morning. Is it going to work? Amen. Amen. Sarah Spence is going to come up and share a song with us this morning. As long as everything goes well. If not, I know we've got an awesome word ready for today. I'm excited. Yes.
Good morning. So this song is called Worthy of It All. And if you know it, please sing with me. bounds before the Lamb of God and sing. All the saints and angels bow before your throne. All the elders cast their crowns before the Lamb of God and sing, "You are worthy of it all. You are worthy of it all. For from you are all things, and to you are all things. You deserve the glory." Saints and angels bow before your throne. All the elders cast their crowns before the Lamb of God and sing, "You are worthy of it all. You are worthy of it all. For from you are all things, and to you are all things. You deserve the glory. You are worthy of it all. You of it all. For from you are all things, and to you are all things. You deserve the glory. Night and day, day and night, let incense arise. Day and night, night and day, let incense arise. Day and night, night and day, let incense arise. Day and night, night and day, let incense arise. Day and night, night and day, let incense arise. Day and night, night and day, let incense arise. Day and night, night and day, let incense arise. Day and night, night and day, you are worthy of it all. You are worthy of it all. And to you are all things. You deserve the glory. You are worthy of it all. You are worthy of it all. For from you are all things. And to you are all things. You deserve the glory. For from you are all things. And to you are all things. For from you are all things. And to you are all things. For from you are all things. And to you are all things. You deserve the glory.
Amen. He's worthy of it all. I think that's got to be one of my most favorite songs here lately. Well, that's an awesome job, Sarah. Thank you. I can feel God here this morning. He wants to move in your life, but real quickly, I'm going to give an update on Pastor Matthew and family. Just want to let you know, they wanted everybody to know that they've been having a good week. They went to the zoo in Knoxville this week. I know the kids enjoyed that, and I'm pretty sure Matthew enjoyed the monkeys. But they went to Winter Jam last night. I'm sure y'all have seen some of the pictures on the church app. Isn't it good to be able to spend time with family? It's good to spend time with family. And this morning, we've got family with us, ready to bring the word. So Pastor John, hey y'all, did y'all see my boots? I wore the Union Jacks just for them this morning. So Pastor John, we love you. Miss Jean. Oh, wow. Let's just give him a hand this morning.
Amen. I really enjoyed that song. That was beautiful. Beautiful and beautifully sung. Thank you. Yeah. And a wonderful introduction to the message that John is going to bring this morning. So God is good. So if you have your Bibles with you, or something that you have a Bible on, we're going to be reading from 2 Samuel chapter 6, the first 15 verses. And I'm going to read it. This is what little bird's eye view into what we do usually on a Sunday morning. I do the reading for him. And I typically will read it in the translation that I like to read, which is the ESV, English Standard Version. And then he will preach from the New King James. So they get it, two different versions on a Sunday. So starting at verse 1, chapter 6, 2 Samuel. David again gathered all the chosen men of Israel, 30,000. And David arose and went with all the people who were with him from Baal Judah to bring up from there the Ark of God, which is called by the name of the Lord of Hosts, who sits enthroned on the cherubim. And they carried the Ark of God on a new cart and brought it out of the house of Abinadab, which was on the hill. And Uzzah and Ahio, the sons of Abinadab, were driving the new cart with the Ark of God. And Ahio went before the Ark. And David and all the house of Israel were celebrating before the Lord with songs and lyres and harps and tambourines and castanets and cymbals. And when they came to the threshing floor of Nacon, Uzzah put out his hand on the Ark of God and took hold of it, for the oxen stumbled. And the anger of the Lord was kindled against Uzzah, and God struck him down there because of his error, and he died there beside the Ark of God. And David was angry because the Lord had broken out against Uzzah, and that place is called Perez Uzzah to this day. And David was afraid of the Lord that day, and he said, "How can the Ark of the Lord come to me?" So David was not willing to take the Ark of the Lord into the city of David. But David took it aside to the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite. And the Ark of the Lord remained in the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite 3 months. And the Lord blessed Obed-Edom and all his household. And it was told King David, "The Lord has blessed the household of Obed-Edom and all that belongs to him because of the Ark of God." So David went and brought up the Ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom to the city of David with rejoicing. And when those who bore the Ark of the Lord had gone 6 steps, He sacrificed an ox and a fattened animal. And David danced before the Lord with all his might, and David was wearing a linen ephod. So David and all the house of Israel brought up the ark of the Lord with shouting and with the sound of the horn. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I'm sure most of us would be familiar with that scripture. And remember the story?
Yeah.
It's a tremendous account. And the title of my message is A Servant Boy by Choice. A Servant by Choice. And my text is in 2 Samuel 6 and verse 11. The ark of the Lord remained in the house of Obed-Edom, the Gittite, 3 months, and the Lord blessed Obed-Edom and all his household. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord, that your word is always relevant. It's always up to date. And Lord, I pray that as we take a few moments this morning to listen to what you are saying at this time, at this moment, and I think maybe, Lord, with all of us, that is maybe one of the hardest things is to stop and listen to your voice. I pray, Lord, that you would speak to us this morning. We pray, Lord, especially for Pastor Matthew and Cherish and Evie and Ellie, Emily and Esther, that you would be with them today. You will bless them, Lord. You would totally restore them. Lord, I know what they have been through, such a journey. And not only them, but this whole church. And we stand with them and we lift them up this morning before your throne. We thank you, Lord, for your healing. We thank you, Lord, for your grace. We thank you, Lord, for your power today working in our lives. And I pray, Lord, that as we take a few moments to look at this amazing account in your word, that you would speak to our hearts. Lord, you would give us a word in season that we can take with us, Lord, that will give us strength for the journey. We give you praise. Jesus' mighty name. It's an honor to be here this morning. And you know, we don't ever take for granted God's presence, God's blessing on our lives. And I know and I understand that to get to the place where God has for us, we have to go through some tough places. And I think that, you know, the things that we have to face in our lives that are difficult are very often the things that shape us. They're the things that make us who we are. And unless you've been through a hard place, nobody really understands the pain that you feel. But there's one person who does. That's Jesus. He suffered probably more than any other man. He died that we might go free. So the title of my message is A Servant by Choice. 2 Samuel 6 verse 11 says, the ark of the Lord remained in the house of Obed-Edom, the Gittite, 3 months. And the Lord blessed Obed-Edom and all his household. The first mention of this man is after the death of Uzzah, who reached out and all he did was to reach out to steady the ark. And I think I've found in my life, and those of us that have been on the journey a little time, that we have to do it God's way. There aren't any shortcuts. There isn't any easy road, and we cannot move ahead of God. And sometimes in our lives, God is just saying to us, you know, slow down. I like to do things, you know, sort of in a hurry. That's the way I was raised. I brought up in London. My mother, her, I think my mother's second name was Nell. And I think I grew up with that mentality that we had to see things happen now. But with God, it doesn't happen that way. We have to realize that God has got a plan, and maybe we haven't got the message, and we're trying to go along in our own strength, and we've left him behind. And so life is made up of choices. And the choices that we make in our lives are what will change us and change our family and change our heritage. And so this man, Edom, his choices and his life led to blessings for himself and his family. The meaning of Obed-Edom means a servant. And I think the moment that we think that we're anything more than a servant, that we have lost God, we've lost our way. Obed-Edom was a bodyguard to David and a musician. He was a gatekeeper in the tabernacle. And the first mention of him was after Uzzah steadied the ark. He put his hand out to steady the ark, and he died. So why was it that God blessed him and his household? Why did David choose his house to house the Ark of the Covenant? Maybe, just maybe, God has called us to carry the presence of God. To understand his presence, to understand his way, to understand the anointing of God and the blessing of God that is upon our lives. It doesn't happen in a few minutes. We have to go through with God. We have to go through the difficult times. We have to go through the hard times, because it is in those times that God is shaping us and God is making us. The amazing thing was, for 3 months, the ark remained in his house. We may say, why me? Why Calvary Church? Why has God called us to house the very presence of God? Because God is shaping us. God is making us. God is preparing us to manifest his power and his glory. Can you imagine having the Ark of the Covenant in your house for 3 months? And I've said to the Lord so many times in my life, why me? Why couldn't I just live an ordinary life? I didn't need to be in ministry. I had a job and I was very successful. But when God called me, and when I heard the voice of God, there was no hesitation. I said, yes, Lord, I'm available for what you want to do in my life. And you may not be called to an ordinary life. You may not be called to a nice, comfortable place and a comfortable position. But I want to tell you, if you're willing to lay down your life for Jesus, you will never, ever go without. And some of you young people, like with me, I was 14 when God called me. I gave my heart to the Lord when I was 7, but I made a decision when I was 14 years of age that I would serve the Lord for the rest of my life. And some of you young people, there's a struggle. I know, I've been there. God is calling you. You may not be called to be a preacher or married to a preacher, but maybe the call of God is different for you, but God is still calling you because he has a plan for your life, and it's relevant to you today, and you cannot escape it because you know God is calling you, and God has a plan that is far greater than where we are right now. It seems often God calls us when others maybe are more qualified. Jesus said in John 15 and verse 16, "You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit and that your fruit should remain." I know I've asked the question of the Lord so many times, why was Jesus born in Nazareth? Why was he born in a carpenter's home with such a humble beginning? The Son of God, the King of Kings, and the Lord of Lords was born in that little town of Nazareth. And I've been there. And I've been in the temple where Jesus read that scripture, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me." The reason God calls us is because he sees our heart. And we have no other agenda than to serve him. And I want to tell you, it's the most wonderful thing to know his anointing, to know his blessing and direction for our lives, because there's nothing else that will satisfy us. And I thank God that even though David was, in the Bible, was the great, probably the greatest man of war, there was nobody greater, there was no king greater in the history of Israel than David. But he understood God's presence. And so, as we look at this man who God used to house the ark, what a legacy he had. If you read in 1 Chronicles 26 and verse 4, Obed-Edom had 8 sons. Think of his poor wife raising a football team, almost. But it was his faith and his attitude and actions that created a legacy of faith and relationship with the Lord. And whatever we do, our children are watching us. They are following us. And I'm going to be honest, we don't always get it right. But when they see that we are willing to say, "I was wrong," or "I made a mistake," they respect us and they love us. And I know when we came from England, my children were changing quicker than I was. And I realized I had something to learn from them. And I realized sometimes I just had to stop and listen, because I didn't have all the answers. But the fact is, we cannot stay where we are. Obed-Edom had to pack up and physically move to stay in the presence of God. And he set the pace for his family. Whatever happens, whatever place we're in, are we willing to move with God? And the question I want to ask us today is, how do we find God? We may have given our heart to the Lord when we were children, when we were young, but how do we find God today? How do we find his presence? How do we find our destiny and our purpose? How do we create a legacy of faith and relationship with the Lord in the next generation? Well, maybe one way is have more children. But that's not what God is talking about. We have to be the example. We have to allow God to change us in order that we can change the world. Life goes at quite a pace, even at our stage of life, we're busy. But the pauses in our lives are so important. Because we have to stop long enough to hear the voice of God. Today we don't have to travel to a specific place to know the presence of God. So the question I want to ask us during this time of prayer and fasting and seeking God, how do we find God in difficult times? How do we hear His voice? Jeremiah 31 and verse 34 says, "For they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest of them." In other words, God wants us to have relationship with Him because He wants relationship with us. Hebrews 8 and verse 10 says, "I will put my laws in their mind and write them in their hearts. I will be their God and they shall be my people." That's the heart of God. He wants relationship with us. He wants to talk with us. He wants to bring His word and His purpose and His direction into our lives. 1 Corinthians 6:19 says, "Do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit?" We thank God for this physical building, even though it was just an old garage. David's desire was to build a house for God. He actually never got to do it, but David was the one who provided everything for it, everything for his son Solomon to build the house. Like Obed-Edom, who was just a servant, we have to build relationship with Him. Obed-Edom was a worshiper. We have to desire to know God's presence. We may say to the Lord, "Why me? Why did you choose me? Why did God choose Obed-Edom to house the Ark of God?" I want us to see three things, very simple. Number one is desire. Number two is discipline. And number three is direction. Number one, desire. Something happened in his heart a long time before David took the ark to the house. Something happened in his heart, and we may have felt a stirring. We may have felt a call of God, and we don't really know what's going on, but there's a stirring in our heart. And when David took the ark of the covenant into his house, David saw his heart. It says in 2 Samuel 6 and verse 10, "So David would not move the ark of the Lord with him into the city of David. But David took it aside into the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite. The ark of the Lord remained in the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite 3 months. And the Lord blessed Obed-Edom and all his household." Wow. What a great blessing. What a great honor to house the Ark of God. But I want to tell you something. It didn't just happen. His lifestyle was different. There was a hunger and a desire for the presence of God. There was a longing in his heart to know the presence of God. Certainly for me and our family, we had to pack up and move physically to stay in the presence of God. And the question I want to ask us this morning is, are we willing to be disturbed? Because it's not life as usual, and it may never be life as usual again. It may not be church as usual. Mark 11, verse 24 says, "Therefore I say to you, what things soever you desire when you pray, believe that you receive them and you shall have them." Why do we find prayer so difficult? Why does it seem we don't ever hear from God? The Bible says if we pray that God hears us and God answers us. And I will tell you, one day when we get to heaven, your faintest prayer will have got through the heavens. The reason we are here today is not because it's church as usual. The reason we're here is because we're hungry, because we're not satisfied with what we have, because we long to know Him in a greater way. Matthew 5 and verse 6 says, "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled." Jesus said in John 7 and verse 38, "If any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink, and out of his heart will flow rivers of living water." When we come to God, the Bible says He is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. And I want to suggest that Obed-Edom, he wasn't satisfied with what he had. He wanted more of God. He wanted more of His presence in his life. And it was because of that desire, because he had followed the Lord with all his heart, that the Ark of the Covenant stayed in his house for 3 months. Desire means to be zealous for, to burn with desire, to pursue ardently, to desire eagerly or intensely. Are we hungry for God? Are we hungry for His presence? 1 Corinthians 14 verse 1 says, "Pursue and desire spiritual gifts." Are we hungry for God? Are we hungry for His presence? It was one night when I was 19 years of age in my bedroom that God met me. There was a friend praying with me, and God baptized me in the Holy Spirit. I spoke in tongues, and God gave me a prayer language that went with me for the rest of my life. We've got to know God in that intimate place. We've got to know God in that quiet place. We've got to understand that God has a plan for us today, and He wants to speak to us today. So the first one is desire. The second one is discipline. I don't like that word much, do you? 2 Samuel 6, verse 11. "The ark of the Lord remained in the house of Obed-Edom, the Gittite, 3 months. And the Lord blessed Obed-Edom and all his household." What an honor. What a privilege. It's great to have desire, but desire is not, in itself, is not enough. Because if you're going to make it, and you're going to be successful, and you're going to make that trip or make that journey, you've got to have discipline. We have to have a disciplined lifestyle. David knew that he could trust Obed-Edom because of his lifestyle. Because he had proved him. It's not enough to have desire, because along with desire there has to be discipline to follow the Lord. To pursue Him. To pursue the pathway that God has planned for our lives. David, because of that, knew he could trust Him. He had a proven lifestyle. And I just want to encourage you today that even though we may be in a difficult place, God sees your heart and God sees your lifestyle. God sees your faithfulness. Amen. Paul said, writing to Timothy in 2 Timothy 2 and verse 14, "But you must continue in the things which you have learned and been assured of, that from a child you have known the scriptures which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus." There is no easy road. There are no shortcuts. We have to go through with God. And I thank God I had a mom and dad that trained me, that showed me the way, that passionately loved God with all their hearts. And from a young child, I memorized and I learned scripture. And I want to tell you, it's still there today. I have something that I can draw on, because from a child I've known God. From a child I've had a hunger in my heart to know Him in a greater way. And I believe that God is about to show us something if we will wait and allow Him to move in our lives and in our lifestyle. Obed-Edom, his job description, he was a gatekeeper. He was a doorkeeper. What else did he do? Some of you should know. He was a musician. He had responsibility. Music brings the presence of God. I thank God for a wife who is a better musician than me and can play and sing. And that's a blessing. But Obed-Edom became a gatekeeper and a doorkeeper, a musician. In other words, he had responsibility. He wasn't just running around, you know, sort of jamming, having a good time. He had responsibility where? In the house of God. He was passionately following the Lord with all his heart and with all his life, and it was due to his desire and his lifestyle. God began to bless him and promote him. And I want to tell you, our desire has to translate into lifestyle and requires discipline. There are no shortcuts. If you're going to pass exams and you're going to do good in school, you have to work. Amen. Unless you're extremely smart. I won't talk about that, but whatever I've got, I've always had to work for it. I will say this. Had many years of music training, piano, learning piano. Many years. I was the eldest of three brothers, and we all had music lessons, and they just quit. But I don't know why it was, but I just kept on going. 20 minutes practice every day for years. But I'm not really a musician. I don't understand music in the way that maybe some of you guys do. And God hadn't called me, as much as I love worship and praise and that kind of music, I had to put that down because God had called me to preach. But I thank God for a wife who passionately loves God and can do a great job and a better job than me. But Obed-Edom was listed with the musicians. He's listed in 1 Chronicles 15 and verse 18. He was a musician and a worshiper. He learned to play music. He had 68 associates ministering regularly before the Lord in worship. Wow, that's some worship team, wasn't it? And he still continued to keep the gates. He was just a servant. Our lifestyle has to change. to bring His presence, to bring His glory. His disciplined lifestyle brought the very presence of God. And I believe that we're going to witness probably one of the greatest moves of God. I still believe this. My dad believed it. Before he died, he was going to see great revival. He didn't see it. But I believe that we're going to see one of the greatest moves of God the world has ever seen. If you listen to the news and read the newspapers, you realize the world is an extremely evil place. But I believe that God is still in charge. I believe that God has a plan. Do we believe that? God has a plan for Calvary Church. Number three is direction. 2 Samuel 6, verse 12. So David went and brought up the ark of God. Wow. From the house of Obed-Edom to the city of David with gladness. We have to wait God's time. I want to say this morning. God understands the pain that you feel. God understands the struggle. You may be saying, why does nobody understand me? Why is it I can't seem to connect with anybody? God understands the pain, but God has a time. God has a plan. God has a plan for your life. I believe I'm speaking maybe to some older people, but young people, God has a plan for your life. God understands the confusion that you feel. For 3 months, the ark stayed in his house. There's a saying in Southwest Virginia that goes like this: don't rush off. I know when I first moved to Plum Creek, somebody said to me, don't rush off. And I thought, well, they just want me to stay a bit longer. They were just really saying, well, it was so good to have you here, right? So I just stayed a bit longer. But God's saying to us today, don't rush off. Because He wants to bring direction to our hearts and our lives. For 3 months, the ark stayed in his house. It's our ability to wait on God. It's our ability to wait for Him and not be in a hurry and realize that we cannot move ahead of God. We have to wait for Him, and we have to wait for the word of the Lord. We have to wait for His presence, because God is in this place, but He has a timing. He has a plan that is far greater than ours. I think probably some of the most patient people you'll ever meet is a farmer. Because a farmer has to learn to wait. It says in James 5 and verse 7, see how the farmer waits for the precious fruit of the earth, waiting patiently for it until he receives the early and the latter rain. I don't think that we're desperately in need of rain right now. I think we probably have plenty. I don't know. But if a farmer doesn't have rain, then his crops are not going to grow. The reason that Obed-Edom had direction was he was willing to move with God. He could have stayed where he was and lived off his past relationship with God. And isn't that the problem with the church today? We are living on our past relationship, and we've got into a bunch of religion because it's more comfortable. We've got to have a relationship with God today. He had direction because he was willing to move with God. And whatever has happened in our lives, whatever has happened in this past year, we have got to move on. He could have stayed where he was, but he had a desire to move on with God. And it was his desire that brought direction. He was willing to do whatever it took to move with God. Wow. You may say, Pastor John, where do I fit? Where do I belong? Obed-Edom, his order, the Levites were doorkeepers, whose duties including watching over the ark in the sacred tent. Wow. Just a humble job. Just a servant. But what an honor. It's such a blessing when we serve. Amen. When we serve in whatever God has called us to do. David said in Psalm 84 and verse 10, for a day in your courts is better than 1,000. I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of wickedness. And we know David didn't always get it right. David made some bad mistakes in his life, but he's the only man in the Bible who was called a man after God's own heart. What an honor. What a privilege to serve the Lord. And the question I have to ask myself is, am I willing to be a servant? Am I willing to open my heart to what He wants? He was a gatekeeper. He was a musician in the house of God. His sole purpose was to serve the Lord and serve the King. But I think the most important thing about this man, the Bible doesn't tell us much about him. He was a worshiper. And he loved the presence of God. It says in 1 Chronicles 15 verse 16, so David spoke to the chief of the Levites to appoint their brethren to be singers with instruments of music. He's listed with the musicians. If anybody understood music, David did. David was a great musician, but more than that, David was a worshiper. He understood the presence of God. And those pauses in our lives, and I want to say this morning, those pauses in our lives are so important that we take stock and we wait and we listen to God. We listen to what God is saying. Because I want to say this morning, there is a place for you in Calvary Church. There's a job that you can do that nobody else can do. But it's in our love, it's in our worship for God that God will show us the way. This man who was used mightily by God to house the Ark of the Covenant was listed as a musician in the house of God. And people may say, well, what do you do? Well, I just play a guitar, whatever it may be. Come on, he was listed with the musicians, and he was a worshiper in the house of God, and it changed his lifestyle. He was willing to move with God. So if we're going to see God move in our lives, the first thing is there has to be desire. Long before the ark came to his house, there was a desire in his heart to know the presence of God. And God wants to reveal himself to us today. God wants to speak to us today. And sometimes it's not always easy, I know, to hear from God. I was listening to Charles Stanley and his son talking on a recording the other day, and I don't know if you know this, but he retired, I think, from the ministry a couple of years ago. He's pastor emeritus now. But he recounts this story how that it was coming up to an Easter Sunday, and he didn't have a word. He didn't know what to preach. And he got to Saturday, and he still got no word, had no clue what he was going to do. You ever felt like that? And he was sharing with his son and said, I just laid on the floor and prayed. Guess what? God spoke to him. Because he was preaching on Sunday, so he must have done. But sometimes we've got to wait for God. But for us to wait, there has to be desire in our hearts to know him. With desire, there has to be discipline. We have to stay the course. The ark remained in his house for 3 months. You may say that's not very long. That's a long time to have the very presence of God in your home. To have the discipline not even to go and check it out, you know. I think he probably seen the mistake that his buddy had made earlier. But there has to be a disciplined lifestyle. We have to go the course. And it is in that atmosphere that God brings direction. So David went and brought up the ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom with gladness, with music, with dancing. You remember how that Micah looked out of the window and she despised him. Don't ever be ashamed of your dancing. Don't ever be ashamed of your worship. Don't ever be ashamed of being radical for God and bringing the presence of God. Because I want to say, you're doing a great job. God is with you. God is in this place. God has a timing. We have to move in his timing. When we think it's right, it may not be right. And I learned as a pastor for many years, you have to wait for God. Wait for God's timing. And I wouldn't have believed that I would be in Saltville in a Baptist church preaching the Word of God to people that are filled with the Holy Ghost and people that are passionately in love with God. And we're seeing that church restored. We're seeing God doing amazing things. People who were in that church for years who left are coming back, and God is restoring that house of God. And guess what? When it's restored, then my job will be done. God will bring somebody else. But we just have to do our part. Because there is a shaking. There is a shaking in the earth. There is maybe a shaking in our lives. And sometimes it comes extremely close to home. But as we lift our hearts to the Lord, and as we stay on the course, and as we realize that God is with us, and God has a plan, God will make us stronger through those experiences. I thank God for his faithfulness. I thank God that he never, ever gave up on me. I thank God that for your faithfulness and your willingness to go the distance. Let's pray. Father God, this morning, we thank you for your presence. We thank you, Lord, for your anointing in this place. We thank you, Lord, for the music that's in this place, the music that's in this house. And I pray, Lord, that you would lead us. You would direct us, Lord. You would show us the way, Lord, as we wait upon you. You've said, Lord, that those who wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Lord, we need your strength. I realize, Lord, I can't do it anymore in my strength. I can't do it anymore in my natural strength. But Lord, our strength is in you. It's in our weakness, Lord, that we're made strong. As the Word of God says, my strength is made perfect in weakness. Lord, this morning we respond to you. We respond to that call of God that's on our lives. We respond to the call of God that is on this church and families, young people, children. Open the heavens upon us this day, we pray. In Jesus' mighty name. Let's give the Lord a praise this morning. Can we get Miss Jean a microphone or something? The piano? You have any microphones around here? What? I'm going to sing a little song that we brought with us from England. It's so good to sit in your presence, O Lord. There is nothing like the presence of God in our lives. Amen.
Do you realize?
Let's sing it.
Precious moments.
Privileged people. Let's give the Lord a praise. That might be a little different style to what you're used to. But God is good. So somebody want to close in prayer? Come on, Kevin. Close us out in prayer.
Josh.
To match my, you know, manliness with pink. All right. So, Pastor John, as always, awesome message. Appreciate you coming out, giving it to us. The Word, I swear, every time I hear him preach, he always brings something that just blesses my soul. So, hopefully you guys receive something from it as well, you know. And really, it's the challenge to us. You know, if we really want to have the presence of God, we have to have those things. We have to have the desire. And we have to really have the desire, not just, oh, I want to have that.
Yeah.
It needs to be, I really want to have that. I need to make the changes. I need to have that discipline to be able to make the changes, to live the life that I'm supposed to have. And in all honesty, accept the direction that God has for us. Because so many times we want to go our own way. And we think our own way is the right way until God proves us wrong. So this is our challenge. Do you have the desire? Do you have the discipline? And are you willing to have the direction that God has set for you so that you have that presence? You experience that life that God wants for us. It's not going to be an easy route, but it's going to be the route that is going to ultimately be the happiest for you. Because even in the struggles, you're going to feel God's presence.
Amen.
So if you would, just bow your heads. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this time, Lord. We thank you for this message. And Father, we just pray that, Lord, you would just help us to just take this in, Father, and really apply it to our lives. That, Father, we might follow you as we should, and Father, we would have that desire, that discipline, that follow that direction, Father, just be able to be one with you, that we might be in your presence at all times, Father, and that we would trust in you in all things. So, Father, go with us now, Lord, as we separate and go our different ways. We just pray that, Father, you would just help us, Lord, to follow you and be the servants to you that we should be. So, Father, we thank you. We praise you, Father God. Go with us now, Lord, for it's in Jesus' name we ask these things. Amen. Amen. All right, everybody, thank you for coming out. We have refreshments. Love you guys. Mean it.